just look at this and see what this is. Good morning, everyone. The meeting will come to order. I want to welcome the Internal Revenue Service Commissioner, John Koskinen, to our committee here today to discuss the 2016 IRS budget request. This is a busy time for the IRS, and so, Mr. Commissioner, we appreciate you being here today to share your testimony and answer any questions we might have. Now, for 2016, the IRS is requesting a massive $2 billion or 18% increase. Commissioner, last month you told the Senate Finance Committee that the IRS was not asking for a budget increase, but just for the money that was taken away from you, presumably by this committee. And it came as a surprise to me to learn that you might believe the IRS is entitled to $13 billion, because entitlements are for programs like Social Security and Medicare and Medicaid. National security, it's a constitutional duty, but even the Department of Defense has to appear before the Appropriations Committee. They have to justify their budget request. They have to subject themselves to the congressional oversight before Congress provides DOD with any funds, and so IRS has to do the same. Now, contrary to what we all read in the media from time to time about this committee, we're not here to simply punish the IRS. We're here to hold the IRS accountable to the use of the taxpayers' dollars. And we deliberately lowered the IRS funding to a level that will make the IRS think twice about what you are doing and why you're doing it. Because you don't have a single dime to spare on anything frivolous or foolhardy or even mediocre. Now, the IRS should focus on core missions of providing taxpayer services, such as processing returns and issuing refunds, providing customer service like answering the telephone, and catching tax cheats. If the IRS wants more solid and sustainable funding, then the IRS needs to show Congress and the American taxpayers that it can manage its funding responsibly and administer the tax code in an objective way. But unfortunately, it seems like we read week after week after week about one form of IRS mismanagement or another, such as overlooking 50,000 tax returns filed using incorrect information, hiring former employees with known conduct problems, paying bonuses to tax delinquent employees, frequent and costly executive travel, lax oversight of purchase cards, lavish spending on conferences, and last but not least, applying extra scrutiny to certain tax-exempt organizations. And then, to add insult to injury, the budget request seeks to eliminate some of the key provisions that we on this committee added that were put there to help the IRS move past this series of mismanagement. A provision that says you cannot target, well, that's not in the request. A provision that requires videos to be reviewed for appropriateness, that's gone. A provision that requires compliance with the federal tax records, that's gone. A provision that guards against excessive conference spending, that's not there in the request. There's a provision that we put in to uphold the confidentiality of tax returns, that's gone. Now, to me, these are just common sense, good government reforms that we put in the bill to help restore the trust in the IRS. So I hope that when you submit your 2017 budget, that you might think about adding them back to your budget request. Now, we talk about doing more with less around here. These are tough economic times, and Commissioner, I've heard your complaints that doing less with less, it's hard to do less with more. But I want to remind you that additional dollars are not the only solution. In fact, last month, the General Accountability Office, the so-called GAO, nonpartisan group, here's what they said, quote, "Although resources are constrained, IRS has flexibility in how it allocates resources to ensure that limited resources are utilized as effectively as possible, magnifying the importance of strategically managing operations to make tough choices about what services to continue providing and which services to cut, end quote. So instead of asking for the money that has been taken away from you, what I would hope that you would do is to study your budget line by line, prioritize your activities, re-engineer your business processes to deliver these priorities. And this is your opportunity to show this committee and to show all Americans that it's no longer business as usual with the IRS. This is an opportunity to show that you've shaken things up. Things have been turned around. We hope you'll do that. And finally, I just want to highlight some landmark legislation that was enacted last year called the Achieving a Better Life Experience Act, or the so-called ABLE Act. The ABLE Act opens the door to a brighter future to millions of Americans with disabilities, allows them to set up a tax-free savings account similar to a 529 to save for college. Now, states are responsible for administering this program, and some of the states have already started the legislative process to create these ABLE Acts, but the IRS is required to regulate. They've got to issue regulations by June the 19th. And so I fully expect the IRS is going to meet that statutory guideline. So again, let me thank you, Mr. Commissioner, for being here today. Let me turn to my distinguished ranking member, Mr. Serrano, for any comments he might have.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I join you in welcoming the Commissioner back before the subcommittee. We're here today at a very serious time for the Internal Revenue Service. Last year, the IRS budget was cut by $346 million, leaving the agency at the lowest level of funding since fiscal year 08. Since fiscal year 2010, the IRS has been cut by more than $1.2 billion, and if some in the other party had their way, they would have been cut even further. The results of these cuts are predictable. Is it a surprise to anyone that the IRS telephone response rates have plummeted? Is it news to anyone that the IRS is unlikely to collect as many taxes when we reduce their funding in such a ham-handed way? This subcommittee has a constant debate about the impact of additional dollars in the IRS budget. But today we debate the converse. What is the impact of less dollars to the IRS and to this nation? We're already finding out. In this fiscal year, the cut of $346 million is expected to result and a $2 billion reduction in taxes collected. The math is simple. For every dollar this subcommittee cut from the IRS last year, the country lost almost $6 in tax revenue that is owed to it. These are not numbers that can be simply be made up by efficiencies, no matter how hard people may try. That is not a sustainable course. As the responsibilities of the IRS grow, we simply cannot keep pretending the IRS can do more with less. The numbers already tell us what they cannot, that they cannot. And this brings me to the IRS fiscal year 2016 budget request. Your budget requests significant investments in the agencies to reverse the cuts sustained by the agency over the last few years. Your proposal plans to invest in much needed efforts to assist taxpayers, to fight against identity theft, to implement the Affordable Care Act and the foreign account tax compliance, and to go after offshore tax cheats. From your proposed enforcement efforts alone, you expect to collect an additional $3.47 billion by fiscal year 2018. It is our job on the Appropriations Committee to vet the budget requests of the administration, and that is what we will do here today. But it is also our job to make sure that agencies have the resources to run effectively. And with regard to the IRS, we have failed in that responsibility. Moreover, the cuts to the IRS don't just impact the agency or even the American taxpayer. They impact our deficit. No one here can claim the mantle of fiscal responsibility if they plan to support excessive and harmful cuts to the very agency that brings in more than 90% of our revenue. It is time to stop punishing the IRS and time to start reinvesting in the one part of the federal government that most Americans have an interaction with. Commissioner, welcome back, and I look forward to your testimony. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. And now I'd like to recognize the chairman of the full committee, Mr. Hal Rogers, for any opening statement he might make.
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much for your courtesy and yielding me time. Mr. Commissioner, we're glad to see you here.
I'm not sure you feel mutually the same way. But it's always good to see someone with strong Kentucky roots in the hearing room, particularly during basketball season, and particularly...
It looks like a good year for
you. Yeah, it looks like it. Well, we'll see. While I think much of you personally, Mr. Commissioner, I unfortunately find many aspects of the budget request troublesome. Since fiscal 11, this committee has pared back IRS astronomical budget requests on a bipartisan basis. This is largely a result of this committee's concerted effort to reduce discretionary spending government-wide, justifiable concern over the implementation of Obamacare and the Foreign Account Tax Compliance Act, and various objectionable management decisions at the agency, for example, targeting certain groups and holding lavish conferences at taxpayers' expense. It's therefore surprising to see that the fiscal 2016 request that you have for us is $12.9 billion. A significant 18% increase over the current level. The majority of this proposed increase, $2 billion, would be utilized to implement Obamacare and the Foreign Account Tax Compliance Act and towards a discretionary cap adjustment. There are a number of issues with this request, but three in particular stand out to me. First, the Budget Control Act does not allow for a discretionary cap adjustment for the IRS. As you know, that would require a statutory change outside the jurisdiction of this committee, a legislative change that has been rejected by both the House and Senate budget committees for four consecutive years. If the activities funded by the discretionary cap adjustment are important to this administration, then you ought to operate within the amount allowed under the Budget Control Act. The IRS needs to prioritize its spending like every other federal agency. Second, this Congress has repeatedly rejected additional funding for the implementation of Obamacare. I am concerned, as are many of my colleagues, that the IRS, through CMS, recently made $2.7 billion in payments to insurance companies without the approval of Congress. The courts will be the ultimate arbiter of that issue, but I can say without a doubt that this committee has never appropriated a single penny to permit the administration to make any Section 1402 offset program payments. Speaking of the courts, I'd be remiss if I did not acknowledge King versus Burwell, currently under consideration by the Supreme Court, which will determine whether the IRS can extend taxpayer subsidies to individuals who purchase coverage through the health care exchange developed by the federal government. While the Supreme Court probably won't rule on the case until this summer, now is a good time to start thinking about the potential impact of the case on the IRS. Finally, I'm disappointed that the IRS requests to eliminate the three administrative provisions that have been enacted on a bipartisan basis for several years. Since the IRS targeting and spending scandals, appropriations bills have included prohibitions against targeting U.S. citizens for exercising their First Amendment rights, targeting groups for regulatory scrutiny based on their ideological beliefs, and making videos without advance approval. We're dealing with taxpayers' money, and these provisions lay out what most people would consider common sense policies. Finally, Mr. Chairman, I want to mention, in the last couple of days, we've seen press reports that there are literally hundreds of billions of dollars annually that are being paid fraudulently to people who don't deserve or earn them under the law. Good chunk of that in the IRS. I mean, this is an open sieve, it seems to me, that people who do not qualify for assistance are gaining lots of money for doing nothing except lying. Your agency is responsible for cleaning up most of that. It's not all in the IRS, but a big chunk is. And so I would hope that we would hear from you today about how you'd want to tackle that huge problem that is ongoing. Mr. Commissioner, I thank you for being with us today. This committee takes seriously our role in overseeing the budget and policies of the IRS and the other federal agencies, and I appreciate your continued engagement with us. And thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And now I'd like to recognize the Commissioner for an opening statement. If you could keep that in the neighborhood of 5 minutes, it'll give us more time for questions and answers. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Chairman Crenshaw, Chairman Rogers, Ranking Member Serrano, members of the Subcommittee. Thank you for the opportunity to discuss the IRS budget and current operations. As you know, I remain deeply concerned that the significant reductions in our budget over the past 5 years are undermining the agency's ability to continue to deliver on its mission. As you all know, the IRS funding has been reduced to $1.2 billion over the last 5 years, and at the same time, the number of taxpayers has increased over 7 million, and the IRS has been given significant additional responsibilities. These include the statutory mandate that we implement, the Foreign Account Tax Compliance Act, or FATCA, and the Affordable Care Act. The disconnect between our funding levels and our increased responsibilities is illustrated to some effect by the fact that 3 days after our budget was cut by $350 million, Congress passed legislation requiring the IRS to design and implement two new programs by July 1st. Implementation of the ABLE Act, mentioned by the Chairman, and the certification requirement for professional employee organizations is occurring while we're in the middle of our most complicated filing season in years. But I would assure the Chairman we'll continue to do our best to implement these two new programs. In discussing our need for adequate funding, I understand we have an obligation to be careful stewards of the taxpayer dollars we receive, and we must be as efficient as possible. The IRS has, in fact, made considerable efforts for several years to find efficiencies in our operations, both in regard to personnel and in non-labor spending. Through cuts in office space, contracts, printing and mailing, we're saving over $200 million a year. We've also made significant progress over the past few years in moving millions of taxpayer inquiries from our call centers and walk-in sites to our significantly updated and improved website. Already this filing season, there have been more than 215 million visits to IRS.gov and more than 3.6 million visits to the section devoted to the Affordable Care Act. We've had over 164 million hits on our Where Is My Refund electronic tracking tool, and more than 11 million copies of previously filed tax information has been obtained online with our Get Transcript application. In the past, all of these inquiries would have inundated our phone lines and resulted in even longer lines at our walk-in sites. But the efficiencies we've created, even in the limited funding times we've had, I think have made a significant improvement for taxpayers. I would also emphasize that we take seriously issues raised about inappropriate actions and activities in the past. We've done that by making necessary changes and improvements in our policies and procedures to ensure these situations do not recur. We've cut conference spending by over 80%. We've established review boards for video productions and training expenses. We've ensured that those who willfully fail to meet their tax obligations are not eligible for performance awards, as well as being subject to other discipline. We're reviewing our hiring process to ensure, to the extent permissible by law, that former employees with prior conduct issues are not rehired. We now require that all contractors maintain the same high standard for tax compliance as employees. And we've implemented the recommendations of the Inspector General with regard to the serious management failures surrounding the review of applications by organizations seeking to achieve social welfare status. But there's a limit to how much we can do in finding cost efficiencies. This year, we reached the point of having to make very critical performance trade-offs, which have had a negative impact on service, enforcement, and IT. The funding cuts have also limited our ability to work toward giving taxpayers a more complete online filing experience. We think taxpayers ought to have the same level of service from the IRS that they now have from their financial institutions, whether it's a bank, brokerage, or mortgage company. We've been taking steps to try to close this year's significant budget gap, and one of our major concerns, as you know, was the possibility of a shutdown of IRS operations later this fiscal year to help close the budget gap. As a result of a review earlier this week, a meeting I had 2 days ago, it's now clear that our elimination of all hiring and overtime, along with cuts in other areas, has generated enough savings that we will no longer need to plan for a shutdown of the agency this fiscal year. The President's fiscal 2016 budget request for the IRS which totals, as noted, $12.9 billion, would help the agency move ahead in all of these critical areas. For example, we'd be able to bring our level of phone level service up from the current 43% to 80%. We'd also significantly increase enforcement and collection activities, generating over $2 billion more in increased government revenues. And we would be able to take steps toward building a more modern interface between the agency and taxpayers. I understand and appreciate the concerns raised over the past few years with activities of the agency. But I took this job 15 months ago because I also understand the critical role the IRS plays in the lives of taxpayers and in the collection of revenues that fund the government. I know I speak for the thousands of professional, experienced, and dedicated employees of the agency when I say we are committed to working with you and the other members of Congress to lead the agency effectively and appropriately into the future. But we need your help and support if we're going to be successful. This concludes my statement, and I'd be delighted to take your questions.
Thank you very much. Let me start the questions. You know, I mentioned the ABLE Act in my opening statement. You mentioned ABLE Act. That's something new that you're going to have to do, write the rules and regulations by the middle of June. That's 6 months. Now, as you probably know, the ABLE Act is patterned after what we call a 529. That's what parents can set aside money in a tax-free savings account, let it grow, and as long as they use it to go to college. So it seems to me that to write some regulations that are consistent with what you already have in terms of the 529 shouldn't be a massive undertaking. So I hope that you can work on that and get that done in a timely fashion. Because on the other hand, there's something called the 501c4 regulations that are not statutory mandated. But if you recall, when we had all the problems with the extra scrutiny that some of the tax-exempt organizations were getting, the IRS decided they were going to redraft the 501c4 regulations. And as you know, the regulations were put out there, and there was a lot of discussion about that. And at the end of the day, there were 150,000 comments. And that regulation tended to offend just about everybody, on the left, on the right. Nobody liked it. And so I guess that's been set aside. But one of the concerns that people had was that if those regulations suppressed what people would consider to be freedom of expression, that wouldn't be a good thing. And they were criticized, again, from the left and the right because of that. So now that, as you, I understand it, are going to redraft those rules and regulations, the concern was in 2013 that they were going to be out there right about election time, and people would be concerned about how they would be perceived under this new regulation. Now we're past 2014, now 2016 elections stare us in the face, and there's some concern, well, are we going to go through this process again? We're going to put that regulation out there right about election time, and people are going to be concerned that somehow these new regulations are going to impact their ability to be involved in the political process. So my question is, what's the plan on this 501c4 regulations? Are they going to be submitted right about election time and have a period of comment, or are they going to be put off till after the elections? Can you tell us exactly what's the plan on this next draft for the rules?
Well, as I said in my testimony, we are going to do our best to meet the ABLE Act requirements and to get that program up and running. Policy is not our domain, but it is a good act. Will help a lot of people. It's not quite exactly the 529 as the same framework, but obviously we have to determine with Social Security what disability appropriate payments are. We'll have to get forms and regulations out. But you're right. It's not something that's brand new. We've already given guidance to the states that they can start developing those plans, and if the final rules vary a little, they'll get transition protection. So we're encouraging the states to start working on those plans now. With regard to the 501c4 regulations, as you know, the previous draft was prepared before I showed up. My position has been from the start that any regulation needs to have several qualities. It needs to be fair to everybody. It needs to be clear and easy to administer. The IG reported that part of the problem that they found when they did their report on the management problems surrounding those applications was that the facts and circumstances test was vague, hard to administer, hard to understand. Part of my concern has been if you're running a 501c4 or 3, 5, 6, or 7, you need to have a clear roadmap so you know what you're doing. You don't have to worry that somebody's going to come in, look over your shoulder, and second guess you. It's very complicated. You're right. We had actually about 160,000 comments. We've been going to great lengths to make sure they all get reviewed, treated carefully. I've read about 1,200 pages of the best comments on both sides of all of those issues. It's complicated. We're looking at, application across the entire spectrum. So it shouldn't be just C4s. We need to make sure that as Congress has legislated in all of these areas, that there's a consistent and appropriate framework for C3, C4, C5, C6s, 527s.
I appreciate all that, but just in terms of the time frame.
Time frame is, I haven't got a time frame. We are conscious of, I made it clear last year that we were going to be anxious not to do anything to interfere with the 2014 elections. This is a change that will last for a long time. I think it's important for people to understand it, be comfortable with it, understand it is fair. And so our goal is not to do anything that looks like we're trying to impact the next election.
But you don't know, you don't have a time frame to say we're going to publish the next draft at, you know, in the next 6 months, next year. You got any idea of when you're going to do that?
No, we had hoped actually to have made more progress than we have, but we are trying to make sure that we do it right. I've talked to several very interested congressmen and senators and said, we're not planning on surprising anyone. When we move this forward, even as we're developing the final forms, my proposal and plan is to talk to you, Congressman Ryan, Senator McConnell, others who are interested. I think people actually there's been a concern on the one hand that there are people who think, well, all political activity ought to be covered.
I understand that.
I'm not bothering. The answer is I don't have a clear timeline for you. I would like to get it out. It will have then 90 days for comment. We've committed to
public
hearings.
You hope, at least the only thing you can tell is you hope it won't impact the 2016 elections. We don't know that for sure.
I don't control the whole process. It's a joint venture with the Treasury Department, but we have a commitment that we're not going to do anything. It should not be motivated by politics, and it shouldn't impact any particular election.
I appreciate that, but I also want to say the ABLE Act that we talked about, that's a statutory mandate. Congress said, go do that by June, okay? We didn't tell you to go do the 501c4. You want to do that, and I hope you'll get your priorities right, do what the statute says, and then if you have time, you can do the 501c4 somewhere along the way.
As I've said on numerous occasions, we do statutory mandates. We are focused on doing the ABLE Act. We have also statutory mandates. I know Chairman Rogers noted that we haven't got much funding for the Affordable Care Act. We don't have a choice about implementing FATCA or the Affordable Care Act. They're all statutory mandates.
Thank you very much. I'm out of time. I want to turn to my ranking member, Mr. Serrano, for any questions.
Thank you so much. I'm really interested in your concern about the impact on the next election, because the gentleman who could take credit for it is not going to run for re-election. We're going to have a new presidential election, so it's really interesting who it would affect or help in any way. For 2015, Commissioner, Congress put the IRS at below the sequester level with a reduction of $346 million from the FY14 level. Since 2010, the IRS's funding has been cut by $1.2 billion, or 10%. When adjusted for inflation, the IRS is now down to 1998 levels. I'd like to ask you a question in three parts. What personnel actions do you anticipate having to take in response to these cuts? Secondly, what do you believe the long-term impacts of these cuts will be? And lastly, how does your request of $12.3 billion begin to repair the damage done by these cuts?
thank you. I finally referred to us as having been double sequestered. When the sequester went into effect and cuts were across the board, all the major agencies except for the IRS were restored to the pre-sequester level. So we operated at the post-sequester level before the additional cut last year in our budget. So we've actually had two cuts while the major agencies are basically at the pre-sequester level. The impact is 75% of our budget is personnel. So as we get cut, we have no choice but to cut personnel. We've lost 13,000 people since 2010. Our estimate is, and part of the way we're dealing with the cut this year, is we're going to lose another 3,000 people. So we'll have 16,000 fewer people. That means we have fewer people answering the phones. We're trying to get everybody not to call and try to get them onto our website. We'll have over the period of time, 5,000 fewer revenue agents, officers, criminal investigators. So our rate of audit is dropping. My concern is that it's not a question just of how much money do we collect. We collect 50 or 60 billion with our own activities. It is, in fact, that enforcement and taxpayer services are two sides of a compliance coin. And what the real number is that we should all be focusing on, that I'm concerned about, is the $3 trillion we collect. We're a tax compliance society, but we are much more compliant if there's third-party information available to us and if people know we're going to use it. If, as a result of these cuts, we have a 1% drop in the overall compliance rate in the United States, it will cost the government $30 billion a year, or $300 billion over the 10-year measuring period that people have. And that's my concern about the impact, is that it's not a short-term impact of do we answer phone calls quickly enough or not. It is over time, does it ultimately corrode the compliance atmosphere in the United States in terms of people feeling the system is fair, everybody is paying their fair share. People begin to think that because we're not enforcing it adequately, some people are cheating, some people are getting away with it, it won't be helpful. In terms of the budget, one of the things I would stress, I think the chairman is correct, our goal, and the comment about giving us lack of money, our goal is not to go backwards. In other words, we ought not to be looking at this in terms of if we get funding, we're going to go back to doing business the way we did before. One of the things I say in my prepared testimony, and I summarized briefly in my oral testimony, is we need to look at, and the chairman's right, becoming more efficient and trying to go forward. And one of the things where we spent a lot of time in the last year looking at is what should the taxpayer experience be 3 to 5 years from now? What it can't be is still dealing with us on the phone all the time, having to walk into our sites, trying to figure out what the right way to deal with it is. People ought to be able to have an efficient way in the digital economy, in the digital world, of dealing with us the way they deal with their banks, with their financial institutions today. So as I say, we're not talking about going to the moon, and it's not as if we don't know how to do it. The Where's My Refund application, the Get Transcript application, the fact you can do an online installment agreement means that we've started to move in that direction. And as I've detailed in my presentation on the budget, if we get additional funding, and particularly in the IT area, we will become more efficient. So my goal is not to say, give us the money and we'll add 16,000 people back to the IRS. The goal is, if we can get additional funding and support, we should be able to run the organization with the number of people we have, and we should be able to have better taxpayer service, and taxpayers should be more easily able to contact us. We should be able to help them fix their returns without amendments. They should be able to do it online. So I think it is really a question, I agree that totally, where are we going forward rather than looking back and how do we get to back to where we were? You know, the taxpayer advocate says, well, we should be doing more preparation of returns in our taxpayer assistance centers. Well, over time, those diminish to about 60,000. Our VITA centers do 3 million returns for people. We ought to move more people into the VITA centers. We ought to move more people online. We ought to get people off the phone, except for those who need to be on the phone because they can't find the answer to their complicated question online. So my hope is to work with this committee, and A, we need to solve the problems of the past. I couldn't agree more with both Chairman Rogers and Chairman Crenshaw about that, and I hope we're building a record you can see that we're solving those problems, whether they're in the budget language or not. But also I hope we can work with you trying to figure out what's the IRS of the future we're trying jointly to build together.
And that's my last comment. I think we've all, probably all of us on this panel, have experienced the changes in the last few years. I remember when filing meant sending in this envelope, you know, that you had to, you know, return receipt and hope it would get there on time and that they would tell you that they got it. And now I sign papers and give a check, if I have to give a check, OCS, and then I don't see it again until it gets settled. So that's where we want to go, to give everybody an opportunity to do it efficiently, quickly. But my last comment is, you're so right. If people begin to think that not everybody is being treated equally because we don't have the resources to look like we are or to actually do it, then you're going to have havoc all over the place, and that's not good for us. It's not good for the country. It's not good for your agency. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. And let me just remind you, my distinguished ranking member, that with the appropriations that IRS received last year, they collected more revenue than ever in the history of the United States of America. Just as thought. And the other thing I would just say, I don't want to get into an exchange, but the 501c4 regulations don't have anything to do with who's the president. They have to do with whether or not, I think that first draft, a lot of people felt like was going to put a wet blanket on political participation. I don't think anybody wants that to happen. So I think they're working on that, and I'm sure they'll do well. I want to recognize Mr. Rogers now.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Commissioner, as you are laying off people, I've got a group that I would recommend to be in that pattern. Some 300 past employees of IRS who had been forced out or left under investigation for performance or misconduct issues. 300 of those people were rehired between January 10 and September of 2013. According to the IG's audit, 141 former employees with prior substantiated tax issues, including five who the IRS found had willfully failed to even file a tax return, rehired. Other substantiated issues from previous IRS employment, including unauthorized access to taxpayer information, leave abuse, falsification of official forms, unacceptable performance, misuse of IRS property, off-duty misconduct, and so on. 300 of them rehired. Those should be the first ones laid off, it seems to me, as you're going through this process that you are. 20% of those, by the way, that came back to work that you've rehired had new conduct or performance issues. One in five of them that you rehired are back in trouble again. I'm no great administrator, but I think I see a chance here to make the world better. Right. What do you think?
I would agree. I've told the IG, and in fact, our formal response is we've taken their recommendations. As the IG noted, in that time period, there were 53,000 employees hired, so the 300 were a relatively small portion of the 53,000. Doesn't mean it isn't an important problem. Part of what it is the vast majority of those are seasonal or temporary employees that get hired during filing season, so the volume of people coming through is high. But we've agreed with the IG that, in fact, and we're working with our personnel people in OPM and our lawyers to make sure that we stay within the law, but we agree. If you've had a prior serious performance agreement, you shouldn't be eligible for being rehired. As I say, the bulk of those people are temporaries. The time period was 2012, and in fact, in 2012, we increased our focus on this, and we've now agreed with the IG that we should review this matter to try to do everything we can to make sure that we don't, in fact, repeat that practice.
Well, you know, it doesn't do your agency a lot of PR good out in the countryside.
I agree.
For people who pay taxes, see somebody as a tax evader trying to collect their taxes.
Yes.
You admit that's not a very good PR.
Exactly. And in fact, separately from this, there is the issue about tax compliance by our employees. And while we have a compliance rate slightly above 99%, much higher than any other federal agency, our employees take that seriously. They understand if you willfully don't pay your taxes, you're subject to dismissal as we go forward. And we have a question has been raised in the past of, well, if you have not been compliant with your taxes, if you're in that small percentage, you shouldn't be eligible for performance awards. And we've adopted that policy and spread that around the agency. People understand that not only are you subject to discipline, but if you aren't current with your taxes, you're not eligible for a performance award as well. And I agree with you that we need to, if I were a taxpayer, the people collecting taxes ought to take it seriously and ought to be compliant. And our employees understand that. And I would stress, over 99% of them are compliant. And we monitor that every year and with every employee.
I would audit that more frequently than every year.
Well, they only pay taxes once a year, so it's a little hard to...
But there's other sins that many of them have committed that are immediately...
On the non-tax issues, as I say, we agree with that, and we're going to do everything we can to ensure that while it was a relatively small number, the number really should be zero.
Because of multiple poor management decisions and others matters, the budget, your budget has been either cut or held flat since 2010. Blame for long phone wait times and the decline in customer service is often placed on those budget cuts. We've heard that. However, nothing and the appropriations bill for your agency explicitly reduces funds for customer service. On the contrary, the taxpayer service account was increased in 2014 and not cut in 2015. That given that case, you've had plenty of money for the customer service. How do you explain the decline in customer service?
Two things. First, as I explained to this committee last year when I predicted that if we didn't get the additional money we were requesting, our service level was going to drop. We knew, and it's been true, that we would get a significant number of increased inquiries on the Affordable Care Act since this is the first year that the filing goes through. Secondly, as we advise the committee each year, we have user fees that we collect, subject to OMB review and approval, that we apply. Historically, we've applied somewhere close to $200 million of the user fees to customer service. Because of the underfunding of, or the zero funding for Affordable Care and FATCA, the only way we could implement those statutory mandates in the last 2 years, in particular last year, was to move a significant part of that support for taxpayer service into the IT accounts, because we needed $300 million and got zero. We still left $50 million of those user fees to apply to taxpayer services, but in effect, the taxpayer service account is $100 million less this year than it's been in the past. We have 3,000, over this time frame, 3,000 fewer people answering the phones. But I would stress one of our goals has been to try to become more efficient, try to provide more information and support for taxpayers not on the call service. I think in the long run, the answer to dealing with the call centers is not just more people. It is, in fact, to continue to provide alternatives so that people, in fact, don't feel they have to call. Most of us never call our bank. If you have a question, you just go online, look at your account, make an electronic communication. Calling your bank, airlines now penalize you if you call them for a reservation. They expect that you will do it efficiently online. We need to get to that same space so that I think I'm concerned about taxpayer service. But again, my point is we shouldn't just put money into taxpayer service and keep doing business the same old way. Everybody agrees. We need to get to be more efficient, and we need to give a taxpayer a better experience than having to wait in line either for the phone or in our walk-in centers. If we could get the system to run as efficiently as the private sector does, which is just a question of investment in IT, then the people on the phones would be the people who really need to be there, and our call level would go up even with the same level of people. So I agree with you. It's not just a question of, and if we got more money, just putting more people online. We at the same time, on the phones, at the same time need to get them the information they need as efficiently as they can. Most people would much rather get it off the web, download their forms off the web.
Mr. Commissioner, I leave you with two words. Go Cats.
Well, as an old Kentuckian, for everybody else, I grew up about 5 miles outside of the chairman's jurisdiction in Kentucky. I share that sympathy, although as a Duke guy, you know, I do have this mixed emotions about how this goes. And then I'm looking, Congressman Yoder promised me last year he was going to hang a Kansas flag outside his office on the building, and I don't see that there yet. But it's a great time of year.
Thank you very much. And I'd like to turn to Mr. Quigley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Welcome, Commissioner. How are you?
I'm having an interesting time and an interesting stage of my career.
We understand. Thought about the fact that after DOMA was struck down by the Supreme Court, this must have changed some of the work that your fine people do. Can you explain some of the changes and how they've impacted your workers and what we try to do for folks to educate taxpayers about the change? Obviously, there's a filing status that many people have never had the ability to enjoy.
Right. With DOMA, as well as Affordable Care and other issues, tax extenders when they're passed, we have a very active program of reaching out to taxpayers to try to get them as much information as we can about everything. We have tax tips. We put out press releases. We do, I don't know how to Twitter, but we do Twitter. We have YouTube videos, all trying to make sure that it's as easy as possible for taxpayers to understand their circumstances. And for DOMA, we've done that, trying to explain to taxpayers what the impact of the decisions are. In short, from the standpoint of processing, If you have, are legally married and therefore eligible to file a tax return jointly, the filing and the processing of that goes smoothly. So the real issue has been to try to make sure taxpayers eligible to do that understand that.
And were there questions from some constituents about whether they were eligible, given the fact that it's not applicable in every state?
That's right. And we have frequently asked questions. Again, we provide that on our website. We provide that in our information and our outreach. We have tax forms every year in which we try to make that clear, to make it easy for people to figure out whether they're eligible or not and to answer their questions. The questions are fairly straightforward. And thus far, we've had no indication that there's, unnecessary confusion out there. We do monitor, what's going on and during a filing season and try to pick up on both in our call centers what the questions are that we're getting asked to try to figure out if people have a recurring set of questions, can we provide them that information, not just individually, but as a group. So we adjust our website throughout the tax filing season. We put out, for instance, on tax scams and concerns about fraud and identity theft. We continue to put out updates.
And let me talk about that for a second, given our limited time. GAO report, the IRS is estimated to have paid out $5.8 billion in fraudulent refunds last year. That's about a 60% increase over 2011. And if you could also comment on the improper payments, EITC, right. What are you doing about both issues?
On identity theft refund fraud, as GAO reported, we stopped about over $20 billion of false returns. It's a battle right now with organized crime syndicates here and around the world. We have spent as much money as we could find to improve our IT filters and detections, but we're talking with people who are filing hundreds of returns and reverse engineering, trying to figure out what our filters are, and they adjust, and then we adjust. So it's a real battle at a very high level.
Some of that infrastructure, is that investments in IT, or do you have the ability, you just have to keep up with them?
We actually are moving more slowly than we would like, and the budget makes clear the amount of money that would help us deal with this. But even additional investments are never going to get it to zero. We are dealing with organized criminals. On EITC, improper payments, Chairman Rogers raised that point. It's a problem I'm very concerned about. Of all the issues we deal with, we've made great progress on identity theft and refund fraud. We've made progress implementing the filing seasons going well, and we've made progress implementing FATCA and ACA. We have not made progress on EITC. We've had a high level of improper payments for 10 years, even with all of the things we've tried. And so I've laid out in the testimony, and I've talked to both senators and congressmen, over a year ago, I put everybody, I said, I want everybody who knows anything about EITC to come to my office and we're going to talk about why is it that we can't make a dent in the problem. And ultimately, when we came away with it, we need legislative help. We need your help. We need to get W-2s earlier so we can match them up at the front end as we go. We need what's called correctable error authority. We know when there are errors in these returns, especially compared against our dependent database. But the only way we can make a change under the present law is to do an audit. So we do almost 500,000 audits in the EITC area, but we have 27 million participants. We know there are hundreds of thousands of additional returns where we know there's a mistake, but we can't change it without an audit, and we simply can't audit our way out of the problem. If we had correctable error authority, we could make the correction, send the corrected return back to the taxpayer. They could then say, I've already got three kids as opposed to one child, but we'd be able to actually move it farther along.
And just to finish the thought, and I hear what you're saying, is it just to discourage us, is this really a question of whether they think they're going to get caught? Are the penalties severe enough, or they just don't think they're going to get caught?
It's a complicated statute, so if somebody wanted to streamline the statute, that would help. But what you have is some tax preparers who mean well and simply are making honest mistakes, and you have some tax preparers who are crooks, who are advertising, come with me and I'll get you a bigger refund, and they're consciously filing false refunds, in effect, confident that we'll catch some of them, but not all of them. We prosecute tax preparers when we catch them doing that, but again, over half the returns in EITC are prepared by preparers. 28 million of them, those returns come in, and our ability independently to deal with that is limited. So the third piece of the triangle is we would like to have authority to provide a requirement of minimum competence by tax preparers, basically that they should take continuing education the way lawyers and CPAs do. At this point, anybody can set up shop down the street in a community center and start preparing tax returns, whether they know anything about the tax code or not. The ones that are concerned are the ones in immigrant communities and low-income communities who hang out a shingle and say, come with me, I'll get you a bigger refund than anybody else, and that obviously can't be legal.
Thank you. Mr. Ridgel.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Chairman and Commissioner, thank you for being here. I was struck by this cover of The Economist, where it refers to it as Planet of the Phones, and by 2020, 80% of adults will have a supercomputer in their pocket. And I think we're all in agreement that the rate of change in technology is just stunning. It truly is exponential. And I think it really, it does stand in contrast to the testimony that you provided, the written testimony. And by the way, I sincerely appreciate your service to our country. That said, I really am troubled by what I read in here, because it's just a litany of woes of funding. And what I think the disconnect that I see is the recognition that technology has allowed for such sharp increases in productivity. When we reference that inflation adjusted, we're going back to 1998 levels, yet we have a 23% increase in the amount of activity or returns filed. Well, at first this sounds compelling, and you'd have to pause at that moment. But when you take into account the incredible increase in the technology, and it seems to me that a 23% increase in the number of returns, for example, could easily be handled. And if a leader doesn't believe that change can take effect and be moved throughout an organization, it won't happen. And I question, and I think based on what I've read and what I'm seeing here, your real belief that you can accomplish the IRS's essential mission within the budgetary constraints that we have as a country and the funding that you have now.
If you read, as I'm sure you already have, the last part of the testimony, it sketches out, particularly in IT, the changes that we need to make. As I've talked about here, we need to, in fact, as our IT head, who's terrific, says, we don't need to be an early enabler, we just have to be a fast follower. In other words, we need to be at the cutting edge and all the risks that would entail for taxpayers. But we need to get, as I call it, into the 21st century and not still be back in the 20th century. So a big chunk of the IT expenditures, which are a big chunk of the budget, would be and are devoted toward, as I say, building toward the taxpayer experience. Because I agree with you. And in fact, as I noted, if we hadn't made the improvements we already have with sort of a clunky system of, you know, 150 million people asking where their refund is, even if some of those are obviously punching the number more, or the app more than once, even if it's only 5 or 10 or 15 million people, they used to call us. They used to say, where's my refund? How soon can you get it? So we need to do exactly, I couldn't agree with you more.
Well,
we need to get more into that area, but you can't get there for free. You have to actually make the investments to go there. Now, this committee's been very supportive of the business system modernization part of our budget, and it's made great progress. What we're suggesting is that we could, with an increase in that information technology thing, get to a future state where, as I say, I don't think we need to get back to 100,000 employees, but we can't end up with the old technology system and no fuel.
We'll try to help you get there. And I try not to approach every hearing like this in just a flat-out confrontational, adversarial way. My father retired from NASA, and I never saw someone work any harder than he did. So I don't start out with some disparaging comments about, you know, a federal employee. Now, the agency has got real issues. And I would suggest to you that as I read your written testimony, and I certainly read about the specific IT improvements that you want to make, I just was left troubled, and I've shared this with you, that how you see the organization and your ability to transform it, a company that's in rough shape like Ford Motor Company was so many years ago, Alan Mulally, I mean, came in there and just did what others didn't think could be done. I want you to be that person, but you need to be constructively disruptive in how you approach the leadership and really push the people in a good sense to let them know that they can do more with less, and this is needed, and this is expected by the American taxpayer. Thank you for your testimony today.
Well, and I appreciate that. You might, if you look back in my background, I spent 20 years in the private sector managing some of the largest bankruptcies and turnarounds in the history of the company country. And I firmly believe that it all starts at the top. You need to, in fact, affirmatively lead an organization. I would just conclude by saying, as I've said, and I mean it, of all the organizations I've dealt with, this is the best workforce. It's a dedicated group of people who take the mission seriously, particularly the mission of helping taxpayers. But you're right. We can't, and I feel strongly that, we can't keep doing business in the old way. So my thoughts about the budget are not, gee, we need to build backwards. The thoughts about the budget is we need to build forward, and I couldn't agree with you more.
Thank you, and I thank the chairman for letting us roll over a minute there.
Thank you. Mr. Bishop is recognized.
Thank you very much. Mr. Commissioner, the IRS, which you say is the world's largest financial accounting institution, gathers very sensitive and personal data on millions of taxpayers every year. And in the past, the security of taxpayer information has been one of the top three management challenges facing the IRS, and it's likely worsened with the current funding levels, as you've not been able to fully modernize your IT infrastructure. Considering the recent high-profile computer security incidents, such as the Sony hack and the Anthem health insurance hack last month, I'm concerned about any deficiencies that may make the IRS systems vulnerable to unauthorized access or attack on a broad scale, particularly now that the ACA implementation is underway and the state and federal exchanges are sharing increasingly more personal taxpayer information with IRS. What are your priorities for improving the information security measures that the IRS has in place to protect against these kinds of cyber attacks?
It is the highest priority we have. We have been fortunate, I'll knock on wood, that we have not had a breach. As I've said, over 100 million attacks a year on our system. If you could get a hold of a database, ours is a database that would be attractive and people know it's there. So even in the constrained funding, one of the things I've and our IT people have said, we need to do whatever it takes to protect that database. To some extent, you always worry about, are you buying belts and suspenders, and you try to be efficient with your and careful with the money. But one area where we're trying to make sure that we're doing everything we can with an antiquated system is to protect taxpayer data, because it is a fundamental basic responsibility we have. And so it is the highest priority, and it's one of the things that does figuratively keep me awake at night. I manage to sleep, but it is a concern I have. And as you see the increasing sophistication of the criminals engaged in all of this, you know that it's an ongoing battle and race.
Are you sufficiently satisfied that the infrastructure is strong enough to withstand
we are. I've put it in other testimony that we are driving what I call a Model T. It's got a great GPS system and a sound system, and we built wonderful applications, but it's still a Model T. We are running applications that were running when John F. Kennedy was president. So one of the limitations, while we've got security, one of the limitations of our budget is that we can't replace. We have about 50 of those applications. We need to replace them and get rid of them, the old legacy systems. When I was the year 2000 czar for the country, we were worried about the declining number of COBOL programmers. Those programs I'm talking about were designed in assembly language, which preceded COBOL programming. So we are running a system that most people don't even know how to program.
You got dinosaurs, in other words.
We are right. So we have IT people have done a great job. We continue to make progress again, with additional support, again, we're not going backwards. If we had the additional support, particularly for IT, we hope to go forwards effectively. But I would assure you.
That makes us sleep a little less at night, too.
Well, we all do. With our own personal
Let me change gears just a moment. My time is about to run out. Most taxpayers and even many of the tax professionals would agree that the tax code is complex and confusing enough in English. While the Taxpayer Advocate Service provides services to individuals who speak English as a second language, what programs and mechanisms do you have in place to assist taxpayers who speak English as a second language, and how effective are those programs, and what measures do you have in place to protect taxpayers with limited English proficiency from becoming victims of identity theft, tax scams, and impersonation?
It also is a challenge, obviously, in this country. It's more than English as a second language with one language. There are, in some schools in the Washington area, 30 to 35 languages spoken. We translate as much of our website as we can, not only into Spanish but into other languages. We have employees who are fluent. There are some somewhat esoteric languages where it's difficult and people need to have translators to be able to work through it. We are concerned that a lot of people speaking another language are recent immigrants, are low-income people, and they're the ones most subject to attack by either criminal tax preparers or tax scammers, because they're the ones, if somebody calls them on the phone, says it's the IRS, actually get very nervous and are the ones most susceptible to be taken advantage of. So we do our best across the board to publicize that, warn taxpayers at all levels about phishing expeditions, how you can be taken advantage of, what you ought to be careful about when some tax preparer says, sign a blank form and I'll file it for you, or I'll get you a bigger refund than you know you're entitled to. And so we take that our responsibility seriously to reach out to taxpayers to try to make sure that they know what their responsibilities are, but also that they get as much help as they can know what they're how to file effectively and how to be protected.
Thank you. Mr. Graves.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioner, good to see you. I wanted to follow up a second on Mr. Quigley's point about the fraud and identity theft. You know, it strikes me that the number he cited was $5.8 billion.
Correct.
Which is more than half, I guess, of your entire agency's budget. And we use the term fraud, identity theft, but in effect it is your agency sending refunds to people in that amount. Is that not correct? So it's $5.8 billion
in effect,
of
the illegal
taxpayers' money being sent to people whom do not deserve it and who are criminals.
Exactly.
And it's being and permissive in some aspect through this agency and enabled through this agency.
Well, it's that's right. We'll process this year 150 million tax returns. We've already processed about 75 million. 60 million of them got refunds. And one of the reasons I've said we need to get W-2s earlier, before I got to this agency, I assumed the IRS got the W-2s at the same time we all get them as workers and taxpayers. We get them in March. So we're actually able to match, but it's pay and chase in that regard. We have very sophisticated filters.
And that was my follow-up to that is, so what is the percentage of these tax payments or refunds that you are issuing that occur during that window in which one can earliest file and when you receive the corresponding documents that verify the income and the identity of the person?
Well, as I said, we've already, we haven't gotten the W-2s yet, and we've already sent out 60 million refunds. You know, close to 80% of people get a refund with their return.
And so within just a few days of one filing online, they could have this fraudulent payment or refund from the IRS within a few days deposited on a debit card that they might have purchased at a convenience store without any match of identity whatsoever, and there's no policy that prevents that.
You've got it right. The policy, the only thing that prevents it, the way we stop $20 billion of that, is with a sophisticated set of filters that look at the return coming in, and each year we get better at figuring out which ones look like they're fraudulent. We hold them, we write taxpayers, we ask for authentication. We've leapfrogged the problem. In the old days when we sent out checks, you know, you'd get your refund in the summer and well after the filing season. By being more efficient, by being getting an almost 90% now of people filing electronically, we tell people we'll get you a refund within 21 days. And so for the vast majority of people, that's terrific. They get their refund in January or February. One suggestion we're looking at is if we can't get the W-2s earlier in the matching, the question is, do we actually go to a situation where we don't give people refunds? The problem with moving 60 million, for instance, now refunds until we get the W-2s is we'd be trying to process then, by the time you get done with 100 million returns in about a two-week period, and even our system can't do that. So
it strikes me rather odd, and I imagine the committee and the American people, that the Internal Revenue Service would, without verification, send out a refund just because they received a submission online through an online portal without verification whatsoever and deposit that money to an unverified account without being able to track it to an individual. But that's what happens, and it's $5.8 billion just in 1 year.
Right, and $20 billion didn't go out because the filters were able to determine where it was those refunds were fraudulent and, in fact, shouldn't have gone out. That's one of the reasons, one of the reasons I've pushed, and we've gotten a lot of support but not final legislation, is we need to get those W-2s in January, not in March. We need to be able to get 1099s earlier.
That is not something that is handled through the agency, but that is actually law.
That's law.
And there's nothing that your agency can do. So it's just a wide open field during that period of time. If I could add just a couple more questions to this. So you would accept a request for refund in this same time period from an overseas IP address as well?
Filters without getting into details. Depending where the return comes from, we now can identify devices as they're coming from. We've limited the number of refunds that can go to a card. So everybody doesn't get totally treated the same way. So if you're filing for a refund from someplace else, we take that into consideration.
Is there a limit to the number of returns that can be requested through a single IP address?
And not at this point. It's just a filter that we use. There's a limit. You can only get 3 refunds to a bank. We can't distinguish between debit cards and bank accounts. We're working with the industry to try to figure out if we could. If we knew it was a debit card, it would be another item that we could add to our filters. And the industry is starting to cooperate with us, and we hope that at some point we'll be able to use that as an indicator. Right now, we have no idea. The numbers are the same. It could be a bank account, could be a debit card.
Well, and I wouldn't at all point the blame on the industry. I don't believe it's the industry. I believe that it's an agency that, without verification, sends out refunds very rapidly, very quickly, and to folks who are criminals and have no verification whatsoever, and deposits that money knowing that they will never get it back. And all the same, knowing that $5.8 billion could go to defense, it could go to so many other needs within our country right now. It could go to lowering taxes on hardworking Americans, but instead criminals all across the country, if not across the world, are receiving these tax refunds. And I'll just make one other note. I heard you bring up a minute ago tax preparers as one of the issues. I don't believe that to be so. I know tax preparers from a professional perspective are very respected in their community. They're registered and oftentimes with the IRS and other associations and do a great job. It's the criminals who are the problem, not the tax preparers who, from a professional perspective, work very hard and have a small business and are just trying to provide a portal for individuals to file their taxes lawfully in a very complicated tax system.
If I could explain, I think that's exactly right. If the 700,000 registered who have PINs can file with us returns, about over 350,000 are accountants, CPAs, registered enrolled agents who clearly do a great job. A big chunk of those 400,000 who don't have any certifications or qualifications are educated and mean well and do a good job. But there's a chunk of them at the edge that unfortunately is larger than anybody would like, who either have no knowledge about the tax code at all and are simply winging it, or are consciously trying to cheat. And those are the people we spend a lot of time now still, without an ability to regulate them, we spend a lot of time monitoring them. We've thrown some in jail. We look for schemes. But again, it's kind of a pay and chase, and that's the only reason I think that taxpayers would be better off if they knew anybody filing their return had some minimum level of tax knowledge.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Commissioner.
Thank you.
It takes more qualification to cut your hair than to prepare your taxes.
Thank you, Mr. Yoder.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioner, welcome back to the committee. Thanks for your testimony today. I appreciate your testimony and your stated efforts to try to run the department more efficiently and try to clean up some of the challenges culturally that have occurred within the IRS in recent years. But I would think you would agree the IRS is still a troubled agency. And things that trouble me are continued abuse of the constitutional rights of Americans. You know, it's been often said that the power of tax is the power to destroy, and I believe that the continued efforts to destroy the constitutional rights of Americans is still a problem that plagues your agency. You know, in the past, we've dealt with the reading of emails of Americans against their Fourth Amendment rights. I believe that's a practice the IRS has stopped. We've discussed this before, but I still have concerns regarding groups who have applications before the IRS being delayed because of their ideological beliefs, therefore in violation of the First Amendment rights. We have headline after headline about the IRS seizing accounts and assets of Americans with no crime required, with no due process, with no right to have their issues heard, their assets just seized. And so my question would be for you, in terms of the groups that have been delayed, there was an article the other day that was entitled Death by Delay, and it said there are numerous groups that are still waiting multiple years or long lengths of time to have their applications reviewed. How many groups are still in the queue, have not had their applications reviewed, are having their applications denied? And then on the issue of seizing assets of Americans without due process, how many assets of the American people are you holding without giving them a chance to speak on their behalf? And what can the IRS do to allow Americans to have greater rights to stand up for themselves before their assets are seized?
Right. with regard to the delays, virtually all of the organizations that were or had been delayed were cleared. We did an expedited process. If anybody would simply say they weren't going to spend more than 40% of the money on politics, they would immediately be cleared. Actually, the C4s don't need to be cleared. They can actually self-declare and go out and operate. So the handful, and it's literally a handful, less than 10 or 12, that are still there, and a number of them have chosen litigation, which is their perfect right, and they can do that. But it has struck me a little ironic that people have said, well, we didn't want to sign the 40%, we have a right to litigate. And my sense was, well, you can do that, but it's a little hard to argue that there wasn't a path forward that would get you through it. But we take it seriously. Back to the issue of whether it's in the budget requests and language or not, my sense is, and it has been very strongly, people need to feel confident they're going to get treated fairly, whoever they are. We should not care, and we don't care who they are. And as they apply, one of the things about the regulations is the rules ought to be very clear and easy to understand, and people ought to see them as fair so that they're not being, in fact, inhibited in their political activities. But they ought to also feel comfortable that they know what they can do and nobody will question them about it. With regard to the seizures, we had a long hearing a couple of months ago. first, there was never an ability of certainly the IRS to seize anybody's assets on their own. Anytime there was a seizure, whether civil or criminal, it had to go to a U.S. attorney. A U.S. attorney then had to make an application to a magistrate or a judge. The judge had to issue an order. Notwithstanding that, last year, after reviewing it and being concerned about this, we have changed the policy, and we've done that in the sense that if you have structured, which is what it's about, if you've in effect structured your deposit in a bank in a way that it causes you not to have to report or the bank to report transactions in cash above $10,000, so if you keep putting in $8,000 and in effect are avoiding the reporting, and that's called structuring, if there's no indication that those funds have come from illegal sources, we'll no longer seize them. And we haven't seized them, and we're not doing that this year at all. My understanding is Justice is considering that same policy. Whenever the assets are seized, now they will be seized only if there are indications it's from criminal processes. Taxpayers have an immediate right to go to court. They have an immediate right to come to us within 30 days, but they have an immediate right to go to court to contest the issue, to, in fact, put the burden of proof on us to demonstrate that, in effect, it's appropriate. So taxpayers are not left on their own, even in the old days. As I say, first there were restraints on what we could do. We had to get third parties to approve. But in this particular situation now, there's a lot of those that no longer happen. But wherever it happens, taxpayers always have the right, and it's made clear to them, to go to court.
Commissioner, my time's running short. I wanted to cover one more topic and to follow up on the conversation regarding the earned income tax credit. And you stated in your testimony today that it's an area where you've made no progress. You admitted that. It's an area that needs to be fixed. It's now $16 to $19 billion in either fraudulent payments or misapplied payments to folks who don't deserve the resources. Your entire budget's $11 billion. So as we have this debate about where to find resources for the IRS or any other budget, we have $16 to $19 billion sitting out there in fraudulent or misapplied payments. That's 24 to 29% of the entire earned income tax credit amount. So it's certainly something that is a huge problem. In last year's appropriations budget, we actually directed the IRS to fix this, and we raised an issue that had been raised by tax preparers in my district and across the country, directing the IRS to ensure that the same questions are being asked of taxpayers, whether they are preparing the returns with a paid tax preparer or via do-it-yourself methods such as paper forms, preparation software, or online preparation tools. My tax preparers tell me that if we treated individuals who don't use tax preparers the same way and held them to the same standards, that we would be able to eliminate a lot of this waste and fraud. And that's been the directive of this committee. So I do think there are tools at your disposal. We'd like to see you utilize those to recover this money.
We're going to pursue that. But in my meeting, famous meeting a year ago when I started with this, it was clear that our biggest problems were the discussions about matching. If we had the W-2 earlier, we could actually match. We have databases. If we could correct the returns rather than having to audit them, we could make a big dent. We're never going to get it to zero, partially because 30% of the population changes every year. People moving, get jobs, get pay raises, and they're not eligible anymore. But we certainly need to get it down. I mean, and my sense is if we could correct the errors we see, we think there are several million returns where we could make an adjustment without having to do an audit. If we got the W-2s earlier so we could match it. And then there is an issue, I take, we're not trying to put anybody out of business, but, you know, it doesn't seem to me as much to say you have to have a minimum amount of knowledge about the complicated tax code. If you want to change the tax code and simplify it, I think that's a great idea. But in the meantime, those three things are help that we need from you all. We're going to continue monitoring preparers. We're going to continue auditing people and checking them. But we're not going to be without those additional statutory support. We're not going to be able to make the dent in the program that I agree with you we need to make. This is, I told people when I started, whether you're, and everybody supports the program because it helps people working and encourages them to get jobs. But we got to get this problem under control or ultimately it's going to kill the program. And so we need your help to do that.
Thank you. I see that we've been joined by the distinguished ranking member of the full committee, Ms. Lowy, so I'd like to recognize her for any questions she might have.
Well, I thank the chairman, and I want to apologize to our distinguished commissioner, but there are several hearings going on.
I could tell that by the cars parked outside.
So thank you and welcome. First of all, thank you so much as a distinguished graduate of Duke. Thank you so, not me, you. thank you so much for taking on this responsibility. We are very, very appreciative and honored. Taxpayers need clarity in the tax code and responsiveness from the IRS. The FY 2016 requests would address the funding shortfalls at the IRS, which are projected to result in as many as 57% of phone calls going unanswered in 2015. By raising the level of service on phones to 80%, the IRS is at its lowest funding level since FY 2008, and if you take into account inflation, it is now at the FY 1998 level. And since that time, the number of filers has increased by 23%. I should repeat those statistics again. I know the chair and all my colleagues would quickly give you all the money that you would like to have so you can do your job effectively. Nina Olson, the National Taxpayer Advocate and the Treasury Inspector General for Tax Administration, J. Russell George, both testified before this subcommittee a few weeks ago and mentioned their concern about the impacts of the cuts to the IRS's ability to function properly. The American people deserve better. We can only be hopeful that this Congress will start to be reasonable and realize that it is harming taxpayers with these ill-considered cuts. So I have three quick questions. If you could explain how this budget request will increase services to taxpayers. Number two, 75% of this budget request is vested in staffing. How does this level of staff funding impact taxpayer services? Specifically, how will this impact call wait times for taxpayers? And thirdly, how much revenue are we losing annually due to enforcement cuts? And alternatively, what would this budget request do to facilitate voluntary tax compliance?
As I've said, I agree with the chairman and the members of the committee, we need to be efficient with the funds we get. If we obtain these funds, you're exactly right, and we've made it clear last year and this year as well. If we had the funds in the short run, we'd be able to, in fact, get our level of service on the phones up to 80%. People wouldn't be waiting for half an hour to get an answer from us as we go. The hold times would drop. We used to, in the old days, back at about the 2008 time before, you used to wait for about 2 minutes to get somebody on the phone. Now the waits are 25 to 30 minutes. And it applies to practitioners as well. As I've said, the practitioner priority line is an oxymoron these days. It takes you as long to get through there as it does here in terms of where we're going. So it's clear that on both the revenue producing side as well as the taxpayer service side, the cuts at some point begin to become negative and very visible, and that's really where we are. The estimate is that with the 5,000 revenue agents, officers, and criminal investigators we'll have lost by the end of this year over this period of time, that that's costing us $7 to $8 billion a year in audits. But as I said earlier, the concern I have is that the combined impact of lowered enforcement and lower taxpayer services, the impact that I'm concerned about isn't just on whether we collect more or less, and the Chairman and I will have a discussion about that in terms of what the pipeline looks like. It really is, what's the impact if, as a result of that, you have a decline of 1% in compliance and you're suddenly talking about losing $30 billion? I understand the constraints. I spent 4 years in the, working in the Senate and 3 years at OMB, so the deficit overall is a real issue, trying to figure out, as I've told our staff, we have to figure out how to get people to want to give us the money and then work with them to figure out how to get that money. But ultimately, my concern is that we're not talking about a short-term issue here. At some point, we're going to put at risk the entire compliance system, and that's not an on-off switch. Once people get to an idea that you know, the system isn't working very well and they can take their chances, you can't turn that around overnight.
Thank you very much, and thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I do hope that in a bipartisan way we can respond to your real concern. The cuts are really hurting taxpayers. So we're all concerned about the deficit, but we've got to figure out if we want to collect the revenue and collect the taxes, how do we provide better services? Thank you very much, and thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Herrera-Butler.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I've in listening to this, and I apologize, too, I've been in a couple different committee hearings today. It's, 'tis the season. Everybody's asking for their budgets. You know, I know that the budget that you are advocating for is would be an increase for your operating expenses. And as the department overseeing the IRS, or as the person overseeing it, I completely understand why. I know that you have received pretty steep funding cuts from this Congress or in the previous Congress, and it's probably getting pretty tough to swallow. I completely understand that. It's hard for me to reconcile this to my constituents when, you know, a couple weeks ago we had the Inspector General, General George, testify in front of the committee, and hearing what he highlighted, and even it, some of it's been referenced today, you know, we talk about the $5.8 billion, you know, he has cited mismanagement of server software licensing costing $100 million. He highlighted, you know, more erroneous tax returns, office space. He said that the IRS could reduce office space by nearly 100 million square feet, saving us about 111 million over 5 years without sacrificing performance. So it's difficult to reconcile, you know, that 5.8 billion more than take care of. It's more, what I believe it's about 10 times what you're requesting in terms of an increase. So it's hard. How do we answer to taxpayers a very rational question? If you wouldn't send out the money that you had in erroneous errors, or if you'd make some of these kind of streamlined the office space, so on and so forth, if you'd streamline some of the recommendations that another agency's already taken care of, then you'd have that part. You'd have that money back. I mean, we could even agree to probably let you keep the money if you went back and collected it or kept it. You know what I mean?
Right. I was going to say, unfortunately, as we get better at collecting money or tracking down fraudsters, we don't get to keep it, and that's probably right. We shouldn't have a bond.
I bet you we can make you a deal. What do you think, Mr. Chairman?
That's right. Well, we've been trying to argue. We do collect a lot of money that way. The point I would make is I spent actually 3 years chairing the Interagency Council of Inspectors General, and I'm a great supporter and believer in the internal audit function and the IG function. The IG has a series of reports and does a great job pointing out where we could be more efficient. GAO does the same thing. The taxpayer advocate, we have a lot of people giving us suggestions. We take them all seriously as we go forward. All three, the Inspector General, GAO, and the taxpayer advocate have said, notwithstanding all that, the budget of the IRS is substantially underfunded and puts taxpayers in the system at risk. So they've all said, there are things we could do, and we are continually to try to do them. Office space is one. We've cut 1,800,000 square feet. We have more people telecommuting. Telecommuting turns out to work very well and efficiently. We need to do more of it. We have a standing rule right now. If a lease comes up, it doesn't get renewed automatically. We take a look at, is there a way not to renew it? We just, in Midtown Manhattan, save $4.5 million a year by not exercising a lease and moving people into other space. So I think the balance is, you're exactly right, and I agree with the chairman. We need to be as efficient as we can, and when somebody comes up with a suggestion, rather than being defensive, my view is if it's a good idea, we just ought to take it. And the fact that we didn't do it last year or 2 years ago shouldn't mean we shouldn't do it going forward. So I read the IG reports regularly. I read our responses to make sure that we're not ducking out on those. Some of the issues have been about hiring employees with the IG noted that had prior performance records. I told our people that that's exactly right. We shouldn't do that, and we're actually going to change that. But ultimately, as I've said, we save about $200 million a year now that we didn't used to save because of space and contractors and others. And if we could move that to $300 million, I would be delighted. But the gap is bigger than all of those efficiencies. But my point is...
it's not, though. I mean, if you look at the dollar number...
Well, I can't take the... As Mr. Graves is there, I can't take the $5.8 billion, and if I get it down to $2 billion, take some portion of that.
I would advocate for you on this side.
I need
you
to talk
to
with you more
what you
about
say.
This.
I'm all in. I'm working with the Forest Service on a similar idea. Let me switch gears. We hear a lot about tax reform and loopholes, particularly from the administration. That's been kind of a hallmark of talking about making the big guys pay their fair share and not taking it out on the small guys. The IRS IG reported in 2013 as much as $2.3 billion was erroneously given to corporations in carry-forward credits. However, the IRS does not plan to follow recommendations to address that. At the same time, the IRS is, to quote Inspector George, dedicating significant resources towards addressing what it believes is the most significant risk to compliance, the use of flow-through entities such as partnerships, unquote. Flow-through entities are S-corps, and more often than not, they're small, family-owned businesses. Meanwhile, some of the biggest users of the carry-forward credit are large, publicly-owned publicly traded corporations. So what it looks like, correct me if I'm wrong, is that the IRS, by extension, the Treasury Department, is ignoring $2.3 billion per year in improper awards to some of the biggest corporations on the planet, on top of the billions they legally save through existing loopholes, so that the government can, on the other hand, dedicate significant resources to auditing those small family-owned businesses. Help me understand that.
Well, first of all, if you look at, again, we try not to reveal too much, but the bigger you are, the more likely you're going to be audited. Major corporations are under constant, regular audit. So we have an audit plan, and we look at what the impact is, but part of the impact is to make sure across the, if we only wanted to collect money, we'd simply audit the biggest corporations and the most wealthy individuals. But that would mean, because the preparers are pretty smart, everybody would understand if you're below this threshold, you can do whatever you want because they're not auditing you. So that's why we audit low-income people and middle-income people as well. So first of all, we don't ignore corporations. Our pass-through issue is subject to a long hearing about, again, we need authority. The TEFRA rules that were great 30 years ago don't apply now because the problem we have is not small partnerships. It's the partnerships with over $10 million in assets and 100 partners. We have 5,000 that have over 1,000 partners. Some of the partners are partnerships. And what it takes to get through all that to make an audit means that most of them don't get audited. And it's a big problem. And again, there's a legislative fix that's in our proposal that we would hope we would get that would allow us to balance that out. Because I agree with you, we need to be fair across the board. No one should feel that either they're out from under and they're never going to hear from us. On the other hand, as I said earlier, if you hear from us, you should hear from us because of something in your return. You shouldn't hear from us. You shouldn't have to worry that you went to some meeting, you wrote an op-ed, you belong to a particular party. That's why you're hearing from us. Even with our constrained resources, we'll do over 1 million individual audits this year. And my concern is everybody should understand those are selected automatically because of something in the return. I don't want anybody feeling that somehow they were picked on because of who they are, what they do outside of filing their tax returns. So your concerns are appropriate, is to say, on the partnership pass-throughs, it's a fascinating problem. More and more organizations are forming as pass-throughs rather than as C-corporations. So the volume of business being done at all levels in partnerships, master limited partnerships, et cetera, is growing. And it's at this point growing beyond our ability to effectively keep track of it.
I yield back.
Thank you. I think we have a little time for some additional questions. I know, Mr. Serrano, you have additional questions? Please.
Thank you. Let me first comment on something you said before, because you were pretty fast with the microphone. The reason that they collected more taxes because more people were filing on their own, because the economy is doing better, and because we have more taxpayers every day. If the majority party, as I think it will, does something about immigration reform before 2016 election, there'll be still even more people paying taxes. And the question is, will they have the resources to be ready to deal with it? And so it's not that we cut their budget and they collect their more money and therefore we need to keep cutting their budget. It's just more people are filing and many more will file if we ever do immigration reform, which, and I've got a little hint that something will happen before the presidential election on immigration reform. Just a little hint. And since this subject was brought up, I wasn't going to comment on it, I do have to address it. The 501c4 issue is 2 years old. Despite the numerous personnel changes made at the IRS, new leadership being brought in, and intense scrutiny from numerous investigations that themselves have cost the taxpayers millions of dollars, the majority party acts as if every day is Groundhog Day anytime the IRS is brought up. Furthermore, they exaggerate the number of employees involved. They blame everyone at the IRS for the mistakes of a very small number of individuals. The employees who are there now are the ones we are tasking with turning things around. You would think we would want to help them so they can be successful rather than mindlessly attacking them. And let me remind this committee that if you look at the comments I've made, which we keep records of, I was as outraged as anyone else that something like this could have happened, did happen, or was happening. You know, I mean, I was not making excuses. J. Russell George, the IG for Tax Administration, who looked into the 501c4 issue, indicated that you have been very open with him and that you have an open line of communications with him. We're very pleased to hear this. Please tell us about the changes in the exempt organizations unit and update us on the cost incurred to taxpayers due to all of the investigations.
Well, as you note, if you go back to who was around at that time and you start at the top, the entire chain of command is gone. So we have new people as the deputy at the exempt organization issue, with running the exempt organization issue, the deputy commissioner for services enforcement, and the commissioner. And you make a good point. The entire exempt organization portion of the IRS is about 900 people. Even with the cuts, we have 87,000. So again, generalizing from a management problem that shouldn't have happened, and it was a mistake, and it's created concerns that I share, but saying that that's exemplifies what the other 86,000 employees are doing obviously doesn't help. But we are dedicated to making sure that that situation doesn't occur again. We do work very closely with the Inspector General. As I say, I view internal audits and oversight and ideas from third parties as important. We're trying to build a culture in the IRS where every employee views themselves as a risk manager and knows my view is bad news is good news, and we need the only problems we can't fix are the ones we don't know about. And as I said at my confirmation hearing, it'd be nice to say we'll never have a problem, but obviously it's a complicated code. We deal with almost every American, and we got 90,000 or 87,000 employees. So my commitment is if there's a problem, we'll find it quickly, we'll fix it quickly, and we'll be transparent about it. And part of the issue in the whole C4 issue has been, you know, some lack of transparency. And I don't think the system can survive with that. So my view on all of these questions, whether it's seizures or hiring employees with problems, is we need to deal with if the facts are there, we shouldn't be arguing about the facts. We should be deciding what are we going to do to fix that problem. And I want people to be comfortable that when a problem arises, we're going to take it seriously, we're going to fix it, and we'll be transparent about it.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. I think Mr. Graves.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just had a quick follow-up, if I could, on a topic we were discussing a minute ago about the tax refunds being sent to these criminals and such. Just from a reconciliation perspective, and it's been a while since I've been in the private sector and thinking through all the reports that were filed, but if I recall, there's a quarterly wage report that's required to be filed, and maybe it's the 941, and it's required each quarter, 30 days after the end of a quarter, which indicates the person's Social Security number, their name, wages and such, and taxes associated with that individual would have been deposited within a banking institution and forwarded on to the Internal Revenue Service. Is that not correct?
We get the quarterly returns. I'm not sure whether we get all that subset detail, but we do. In fact, one of our problems is try to make sure we get the quarterly returns.
And it just seems like to me, and this is just a thought, that that is data. Those are data points, which could reconcile, at least in the interim, until you get the final W-2, which is required to be filed by the end of, was it March 31st, you indicated, that might provide a little bit of data there to work with. And if I'm not mistaken, the fourth quarter 941 was required to be filed by the end of January, which should conclude all four quarters of the previous year should be on file with the Internal Revenue Service, I would say. And then to just one other comment, if we could just provide a little clarity, you've spoken a few times today saying that there, and I guess this is your personal opinion, that there should be minimal training for, in your preference would be that there was minimal training for individual preparers, I guess, or professional preparers who file returns on behalf of individuals. And that might be your opinion. And my opinion of that is that when you make that determination, then maybe the tax code is just a little too complicated. And that if it's required of a professional to have minimal training, how can we expect the average hardworking American to fill out these tax returns as well? But I can tell you this, without minimal training, the criminals have got it figured out. And they're the ones who are filing these fraudulent returns and the ones that are receiving these payments from the IRS.
I always preface my comments by saying tax policy is the domain of the Treasury Department, the White House, and the Congress. We're in tax administration. Having said that, I'm a great believer in tax simplification. I agree with you. When all of us are using preparers to file our returns because we're not confident we can do it ourselves correctly, I thought Congressman Camp was right, that the tax code is bigger than the Bible with none of the good news. I've told him for a year I'm going to give him credit, and then I'm stealing that count. But I think it's totally right that for nothing against tax preparers, they provide a great service, but some taxpayers ought to be able to have an idea that the code is simple enough that you can not spend the amount of, it's been estimated we spend 6 billion hours of time filling it out. If you think of the intellectual capital, you have to be smart to be a tax accountant, tax preparer, tax lawyer. If you think of all the intellectual capital spent just trying to pay, figure out what the right amount to pay and pay it is, and if we put that intellectual capital to some other use, it'd be a great thing for the country. So whatever we can do to help tax simplification, we're delighted to do that.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, how about that? Ending on common ground. What do you think, Mr. Serrano? Yeah. Yes, sir, absolutely. Yes, sir.
I understand your point about the criminals, and we all agree on that. But some of the criminals are tax preparers. And if you go into certain neighborhoods, you'll see plastered on the window, come in here and we'll get you the best break. You know, that's not what they're supposed to advertise. They're supposed to advertise, we'll file your return. And so not everybody goes in saying to a tax preparer in a storefront operation, I want to cheat on my taxes. But in many cases, you have someone who says, come in and we'll get you the better deal. And the better deal is the one that he thinks should send some people to it, at least to be scrutinized by the authorities.
And I understand the gentleman's point, reclaiming my time. My point was is that those individuals clearly have above minimal training in order to figure out how to evade the tax system. My point is, for all the law-abiding tax preparers, professionals out there that work hard every day and have a small business and are trying to help folks, I think they're doing it the right way, and their minimal training shouldn't be a requirement of the federal government. And if it is required, maybe the tax code is just a little too complicated.
And they're the largest group. The fair-minded,
right.
The clean guys and ladies are the largest group, but they're still that small group. Mm-hmm. Creates a problem for everyone.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Button, do you have any more questions? Well, let me just a couple of quick questions before we go. We talk a lot about fraud, the $5.8 billion, and you mentioned the administration wants to move up the W-2s, and then you said maybe if we waited later on, after we have all the information, and then process those returns, you'd have more information and maybe there'd be less fraud. But on one hand, I've thought about that. The taxpayers might not like that. They love getting the refunds yeah. early.
We'd have 60 million who already got their refunds calling us and saying, whose idea was that?
But if is that something you really think about down there? Yes. You mentioned maybe one of the problems is that all of a sudden you'll have to process all those at the end. But I imagine you staff up when you're, processing now, if you staffed up a little bit later. But obviously there's a concern of the taxpayers. I file my tax return, I want to get my refund. Right. But what's the biggest objection to that, to say, rather than you call it chase and file, but say you file your tax return and then maybe sometime 3 months after that, when all this information has come in and you can even do a better job of weeding out the fraud, what prevents you from suggesting that?
We've actually, because I really have said we need to start from scratch, so we've looked at that in terms of what the impact is. Part of the problem is it's not just a question of people, because the filings really are electronic. If we get 100 million, it's about 100 to 110 million out of the 150 are going to get refunds. If we put them all into that last couple of weeks, the system simply won't be able to.
Well, do they have to be in the last couple of weeks?
Well, because if we don't get the information at the end of March and filing season deadline is April 15th, we don't have a lot of window of time. But
no,
we are.
I mean, in the sense, I would say after you file returns in April, right? And right now, if you file return early, you can get a refund pretty quick. But what if it were you file your return by April 15th, but you're not going to get a refund until, let's say, 3 months later, because you got more time to do all the due diligence.
We actually have looked at that and are considering, is there a way to, in fact, delay refunds, and what's the impact on taxpayers? Part of what happens is, of the 80% getting refunds, a lot of them are middle and upper income people, which they do it primarily because it's a pain in the neck to write a check in April, and you'd rather just get a refund. A lot of people are getting that refund. It's the biggest check they get all year, and they are acclimated now, or at least used to, in January or February to have it. They're paying for rent or other issues. Now, even having said that, if you got everybody acclimated instead of being February, it's April or it's May, you have a tough year, and then you'd have everybody, every 12-month cycle would go that way. And we've actually looked at, it's somewhat draconian for people who expect that. We have to pay interest after April 15th if we haven't given you your refund, but even that, today's interest rates isn't very much. So we have continued to look at, are there ways to modulate or adjust? I think a lot of this recently, this week, there's been a survey, the Wall Street Journal did, that found or reported on, that said, well, the majority of taxpayers say they'd be happy to wait away a while for their return if that meant that they were less likely to be subject to identity theft. So it is part of this package of, okay, how do we deal with this? Again, recognizing that we're fighting a battle with very sophisticated criminals with very high-tech equipment. And so delaying refunds is something that we're going to have to look at. Even if we get the W-2s by the end of January, it means by definition you're not going to get your refunds. Filing season usually starts January 20th, so there's going to be a delay built even if we had the returns earlier. The advantage of getting the W-2 earlier is we could spread that delay then out over a period of time much more manageable.
And it might even help with the earned income tax credit. If you had delayed refunds, whatever, it might give you a little more time to
yes.
deal with that. Because that's, you take $6 billion and $19 billion, and somehow if you could collect
half,
part of that, it might be worth taxpayers saying, we'll wait a little bit.
Yeah.
Maybe their taxes will go down if we collected all the revenue. Okay. Last question, real quick, and this is I'm just curious about this. When I read about the 50,000 folks that filed tax returns based on the incorrect information they got, I think there were 750,000 people that got that incorrect information. The 50,000 that filed, you all decided, well, if they owed additional taxes or whatever, you're just going to kind of let that go. I just wonder, is that going to be a problem? What about the next batch? I mean, all the people that got incorrect information, if the next 700,000 that file, is there any kind of due process issue with them, or how do you decide we're just going to, they got wrong information, they filed a return, maybe they got a refund, maybe they're going to owe back taxes. On the other hand, maybe they'll, it might be a wash. But how do you make that decision?
Well, it's a policy decision that actually is made by Treasury in terms of where it goes. Obviously, We've had other programs where you have a transition year. In fact, we've even talked with the states, you know, if you get your program not quite right, you can have a transition time. So this is the idea for the $50,000 has been made clear. This is a one-time, this year only issue. But the point you raise is a good one. If there are other corrections in 1095As, you know, what do you do with that? And the problem, you can make a policy decision, but one problem is the administration of it in terms of, you know, you can complicate our processing issue enough that you actually put it at some risk. But those issues are fortunately affecting a relatively small, out of the, you know, 100, at this point, 75 million, we got 50,000 who filed early. The other 750,000, there were about 800 to start with, have been advised, and they are apparently waiting. They're going to get their corrected, just like you get a corrected W-2, and they'll file their return with the correction. But it's clearly possible there are going to be other errors. Either taxpayers, we've encouraged taxpayers, look at your 1095A and make sure that it corresponds with your experience, and some of them will obviously at some point find an issue. I think the Treasury concern was this was a, you know, not a mistake the taxpayers made. It was a mistake by the government. And so if you've already filed, and the amounts generally are relatively small, the differentials, we shouldn't put taxpayers with that burden. But I think the point's a good one. That if there are going to be other, you know, 2,000 people here and 1,000 people there, you know, in some sense, our view is that, you know, you need to administer the tax code in an orderly way. And so, and I think Treasury is sensitive to that.
Gotcha. Well, thank you. And let me, any other questions?
Just one further question on the subject I mentioned before, just to show you the need to look at this agency as a department that needs resources in the next few years. If we get immigration reform, and this is something my colleague and I have discussed at times, it's pretty much bipartisan belief that you'll pay a fine. Who they'll pay that fine to is the IRS or the Treasury, but that has to be processed. And then a process will be worked out to pay back taxes, as soon as to them, and that'll be huge numbers of people. Then you have people who've been working with a PIN number, which is totally proper. And you have people who've been working with somebody else's Social Security number. You know, all of that will have to be sorted out. So when we look at this agency, we don't look at an agency that will have less work to do in the next generation, but rather much more work to do.
Unless we simplify the tax code and then...
That would help. That would help. That would help. I would note, just in response to that, as I've talked to our employees about it, one of the ironies but good signs is when there's a program and there's an attempt to do something, a lot of times people give it to the IRS because the assumption is the IRS will do it. And it has a history. It's got a great workforce. It's really got, as I say, a dedication to the mission that's reassuring and amazing to watch. But it hasn't escaped me over time, including the ABLE Act and the Professional Employees Act, that people are comfortable and confident that you give us a responsibility, we'll do whatever it takes to try to get it done, even in constrained resources. And I think that's important for the public to remember that with all the appropriate discussions about are we doing it right, are we being efficient, there is a confidence that if you give us a responsibility, we'll take it seriously. We won't make a judgment, do we like this or don't like it. If you say to do it, we will do it. And I think it's important for taxpayers to sense that degree of confidence in the agency, because ultimately it goes back to my real concern, as I say, people have to be comfortable and confident in the system if the compliance rate's going to continue and the process will be continue to be viewed as fair.
Well, thank you. And let's just end on a positive note. Let me thank the commissioner. He's been working with a group called the Free File Allowance, right. Alliance, and they just entered into an agreement. For a five-year agreement that about 70% of all the taxpayers are going to have access to filing their taxes free. That's something he's been working on, and I want to congratulate you for that. Thank you for that, and thank you for being here today. And we'll all adjourn the meeting right now.
Thank you.